So I'm going to tell you how maths can help improve lung cancer radiotherapy treatment. This is joint work with some colleagues at the University of Sydney Medical School. And so to put things in context, lung cancer is the leading cause of cancer death globally and in Australia. It accounts for around 19% of cancer deaths in Australia. 1.5 million deaths worldwide each year, and in Australia this year, over 9,000 people have died from lung cancer, and we've had more than 12,000 new cases. Once you have it, the survival rates are not good. 5-year survival rates are 16%. The main treatment is radiation therapy. So you zap the tumor with high-energy x-rays to kill the tumor cells, and this can be done in combination with chemotherapy, or it can be done pre-surgery to reduce the size of the cancer, or post-surgery to mop up any remaining cancer cells. The particular problem with lung cancer is that the tumor on the lung moves as you breathe, and you can't tell the patient not to breathe while they're being treated. So you have this moving object that you're trying to take images of and treat. And so the aim here is really to try and produce sharp images, but not dose the patient too much with lots of radiation. On the left, you see a tumor moving in a lung, and the orientation is just as if you were looking at me. As I breathe in, my diaphragm goes up, the lung goes up, the tumor on my lung moves up. These days, you can have fancy lead collimators. So these yellow bars are lead collimators that restrict where the x-rays can go. They can move and track with the tumor so that the surrounding tissue is not overly irradiated. Here's a schematic breathing trace. So this is time. This is the person breathing in and out. So peak inhale, you breathe up, the tumor displacement goes up. And we want to take a photo of this moving tumor, but you know, if you take a photograph of some rapidly moving object, like a bird, and your shutter speed is too long, then the bird is blurry. Here we can't do much about the shutter speed. We have to have a long shutter speed. And so the trick we're going to use is we'll slice vertically into levels the tumor location. So at peak inhale, we'll take some images with these red dots, and we'll use that to create a red picture of where the tumor is at peak inhale. And we'll do the same thing for, well, in this picture, at mid-inhale and peak exhale, but in practice at about 10 different levels. So we'll have 10 different slices. And each of these slices we want to do in 3D. And in order to get 3D, we need to have angles around the patient. We need to take beams at different angles around the patient. The machine we use to do this, this is one of the newer ones, so this is a plinth where the patient lies. The x-rays are emitted from the source, they pass through the patient and travel to the detector. And this detector spins around the patient, taking x-rays at different angles. Here's one at the Charles Perkins Center. So the main, this has a couple of different degrees of freedom, but the main degree of freedom I want to talk about is this rotation around the patient that you see near the end of the movie now. So coming back to the schematic, we've got this peak inhale bin. And as we take beams, as this machine is traveling around the patient, shooting x-ray beams through the patient, we pick up a wagon wheel of images. So think of the patient at the center, the machine is going around the outside, and it's shooting x-rays at these angles. And to get a good image, we want to have these angles well spread. Here we've got clumps of three. This is not so great because it's redundant information and we're just overdosing the patient with radiation. The blue is nice because we have single, nicely spread beams. The difference between well-spread angles and poorly spread angles can be great. So you can get, with poorly spread angles, you can get these streak effects. So these crisscrossing dark lines are due to the fact that you have non-uniform angles at which you're taking the images. And this is the picture that you get if the angles are nicely spread apart. So obviously we want something like this, and we don't want something like this where we can't really see what's going on in here. So our optimization problem is we input an average patient breathing cycle. So we get a patient to lie down, we tell them to breathe normally for a long time, and then we assemble all these normal breaths into an average breath that's 4 to 5 minutes long. And we use that to schedule what is going to happen. So the output is, how does the gantry move around the patient? Does it just cruise around uniformly? Or in the case of these machines, they can accelerate and decelerate very rapidly. So this is something that we should try to take advantage of if it helps with the images. Also, when you take the beams, when you pulse with the x-rays to image the patient, that is under your control. So you should try to optimize that. And again, optimal means that in each of these bins, for example, in the red bin, but in the other bins as well, we want to have a well-spread collection of angles. So there's a math talk. I thought I should put a little math on the board just to make it look like a math talk. So we have a 3D array of variables, binary variables, and if you take an image at time S and T in bin B being, say, the red bin, then you set this variable to 1. And if one or more of those things are not true, then you set the variable to 0. So once we decide all these variable values, that essentially tells us everything we're doing regarding timing. And we want to minimize an expression like this. If we make an image at time S and T in bin B, then we want to penalize according to 1 over the square of the angle. So if the angles are very close at times S and T, this is bad. This is redundant information. So we want to penalize that more heavily. If the angles are bigger, then we have less penalty. And we minimize this subject to some physical constraints that I didn't write down. And for the motion of the gantry, this is controlled by a space-time network. And so the results. So what is typically done is you just have these, even though these are very fancy machines that are capable of all sorts of things, they often just cruise around at a constant rate and you pulse every, say, 4 seconds. And if you do that, you get wagon wheels that look like this. And they produce not particularly sharp images. They have these artifacts like the streaks I showed you. Just by retiming, so even with a constant gantry motion, and we can improve further on that, but even with a constant gantry motion, just by retiming, when you take these beams, you can get wagon wheels that are much better spread. And this is completely free. All you have to do is tell the machine, take a beam at a different time, and you get better images. Nothing else you have to buy. So this is really just the beginning of the work we're doing. We realized that, there are a couple of things we need to think about. So patients don't always breathe according to the average breathing cycle. And we need to rapidly recover if they deviate too much from their average. Also, if the tumor is close to the heart, then you get some independent cardiac-induced motion. So the heart beats about 4 times as frequently as you breathe, and you get this independent motion from the heart. So we need to account for that as well. And proton beam therapy is very exciting. It delivers radiation right to the tumor. You don't have this this entrance dose where the x-rays have to pass through living tissue to get to the tumor. But this throws up other mathematical challenges, but we are keen to meet them. Thank you.